Buonasera, benvenuti, welcome to what is a class on campus. It's called Italian 262 Italian Americans in Film, a class that has been growing over time, and it hosts outside events. Thanks to the support of the Insera Endowment, which is linked to the Italian program on campus in the Modern Languages department. My name is Teresa Fiore, and I have the pleasure of introducing tonight our guest, Maria Rapicavoli, Maria Domenica Rapicavoli, more specifically an artist from Sicily, who lives in New York and is here tonight to tell us about a project that she completed in Corleone. This is a place, as you know, that despite its small size, is well known everywhere. And over the years, I was always struck by how many people were familiar with it, how many young people. And when I came across Maria's project, I said, what a unique opportunity to actually hear what happens in Corleone. Judging from the presence of people from the community, colleagues such as Marisa Trubiano, I see Kathleen Bennett, active in New York, Marianne Fusco, writing as a journalist, Eric Perkins, and Diana, thank you for coming. It seems to be a subject of interest beyond the Italian-American class. And so we're very interested in having a conversation with all of you afterwards. For the time being, let me tell you a little bit about it, about first Maria and then the project, so you get to know her better before she gives us a formal presentation. Maria is originally from Catania, and she studied in that city, but she also studied in London, Goldsmiths University, and has been a fellow in the Whitney Independent Study Program in 2012. She's been an artist in residence in so many places that it would be too long of a list to mention here. She has also exhibited in several group shows in many different towns, in the cities in the United States and in Europe. I had the pleasure of seeing her work actually at Manifesta in Palermo, a very recent and important exhibit, an itinerant one that every 2 years goes to a different European capital, and it was in Palermo until November of 2018. What does Maria do with her work? She's interested in issues of power. How institutional power or non-institutional power exists and infiltrates into spaces, into the lives of people, in visible or not too visible ways. And she's interested in the tension between visibility and invisibility. I came across her work the first time because she has also worked on migration, which is a topic that I work in as well, work on as well. And but her take is very unique, and very often she starts from Sicily because it's a place that she's familiar with, but she takes it to other spaces, and she's interested in the ways in which other spaces control what is, after all, a pretty small island, and yet a very important one strategically, historically. And in her work, she has crossed paths with the mafia, speaking of power, visible and invisible, and with the Godfather. Like me, a Sicilian, she was approached over and over again over the years by people who would actually identify her as somebody having a connection with the mafia, and in particular with Corleone. And when we talked about this project, we both realized we had never been to Corleone up to a point, because Sicilians don't go to Corleone. There isn't really that much to visit. If anything, you're not particularly encouraged to go there. But some people have the courage to do so. And this is Maria, who one day moved for a while to Corleone and decided to use really what has become her signature art, which is a combination of video, of photographs, over time also installations that are particularly site-specific, and you will get a taste of it tonight. And I will now give her a chance to formally present the work, and later on we can have a Q&A all together. Thank you so much, Maria, for coming to Monte State.
Thank you, Teresa. Thank you, Teresa. Thank you, everybody, for being here. I'm happy to have this conversation with you. And yeah, as Teresa was saying before, as a Sicilian, there was really no reason for me to go to Corleone. Actually, it was basically Sicilian people avoid to go there because there is really because it reminds us of something that it's painful, which is about money. But when I was studying in London, that was my first impact with the Godfather, the movie, because I didn't see the Godfather when I was in London, but I remember there were a lot of people from different backgrounds. Every time I was telling them that I was Sicilian, they were like quoting the Godfather. Or they were saying, oh, me and you are part of the same family. And I was like, no, what are you talking about? I just really didn't get it. And I didn't watch The Godfather until very late after I moved to, I was still in London, but at one point I decided that I wanted to visit Corleone because there was a reason. There was it was 2007, the first time I went there, and it was because one of the biggest mafia bosses was captured by the police in Corleone. That was the big news because this guy was hiding for 43 years and nobody knew where he was, but he was living in Corleone. And he had three kids. And I was like, I can't believe he was living with other people in such a small village and nobody ever said anything. So I decided to go and I went there the first time just to look at like to see the village, and I start talking with people, and they first told me, like the only people I could talk to by the time were like old men in a public park, and they told me, I asked them like directly, I say, have you ever seen Provenzano? And they were like, oh no, maybe he was here with us, but we didn't know he was him. I was like, okay, so I realized there was a lot, there was much more in that village, and there was something I wanted to investigate more. And so I decided to go there again for 2 weeks, this time by myself. I booked a flight from London and I booked a hotel room and I say, okay, let's see. And I had no idea what I was gonna find there. I had no idea. I was just, you know, intrigued by the contradictions and the fact that for me, Corleone was representing mafia, and mafia for Sicilians represents something terrible, basically, very, very terrible and painful. But for the rest of the world, it was a movie. And I was like, okay. So I went to Corleone, and the very first day I arrived there, I decided that it was necessary to watch The Godfather. So I basically rented the three, yeah, they were like tapes. I watched the three movies like in 3 days while I was there. And it was very interesting. I mean, I realized it was an incredible movie. And maybe the reason why, I mean, I know the reason why that was, I was like, I haven't seen this before. It's maybe because when I was a child, mafia movies for me were too tough to watch. I didn't really want to watch any mafia movie because it was so real that I didn't want to really see that. But The Godfather was different. It's like a masterpiece. It's like incredibly well well done. So I was there and I said, you know, I think we can now see part of The Godfather, and I can continue with my experience in Corleone. Area of Sicily that I visited, so I was familiar with those locations, but it was not Corleone. It was kind of interesting for me to know that, in fact, there were so many people that were visiting Corleone just to see the location, the set of The Godfather. And there is also a Corleone bar that pretends to be that bar, but it's not. So it was kind of, yeah, to me it was kind of interesting to realize that there was much more to discover. And this is a map of actually of Corleone. So I am from Mount Etna, like Savoca and Taormina, so I'm from that area. So that's why I know exactly that I know the location of where the movie was shot. But Corleone is right on the west. And so it's pretty far. The reason why the film was not shot in Corleone is because the very first day Coppola arrived, the crew, they were treated, they couldn't film. They basically, mafia, a lot of people just didn't want to move it to be filmed there. So they had to move to another area, which is, a Sicilian, we call that area the stupid area, because it's stupid in a positive way, because it's not a mafia area, right? So stupid in a very bad we can watch the part of my. So you see, this is like an extract of my one of the works I made in Cologne, and then I'll talk about it after.
Like in the movie, all the buildings, the noises,
the food,
it seems like, and the people too, and all the church. And no, it's pretty like, and I'm really satisfied about everything I've seen. Yeah.
The trouble is, I saw the movie a long time ago, so I vaguely can recall what was the early footage of the movie when the story started. And what I was hoping to see was those old buildings, at least few of them, atmosphere which I could next time see the movie and tell to myself, okay, that's the place, yeah, it looks more or less the same or totally different.
È inutile che venga qua, venga a coprire la mafia, una cosa si copre la mafia.
Chi? Non
c'è la
mafia, non
c'è la mafia. La mafia esiste sempre per quello che non si fa i fatti suoi. Quando non si fa i fatti suoi, faccia mafia. Ammazza e basta, si chiude dopo. Vedi una cosa e la fa comunicare alla
polizia.
Noi siamo tranquilli e dicono che c'è la mafia, e dicono che c'è la mafia, ma gli altri non hanno visto la mafia.
Perché viene a cercarmi? Ma questo è un paese di contadini che lavorano tutti.
Una recita, perché alla fine tutti parlavano di Corleone, tutti Corleone, il paese della mafia, i mafiosi, chissà che cosa succede lì. Io sono arrivata qui, ho visto tutti tranquilli, marchese di Provenzano. Non ti leggo quando arrivano, tu lo sai chi sono, però alla fine ti fai il tuo lavoro da negoziante.
Molti turisti vengono, guardano, vedono i posti, si meravigliano. Però lo sai perché vengono? Per The Good Fathers, è il padrino, e basta. Cioè non è che vengono da qualche cosa di bello, perché alla fine qua non è che ci sia chissà che cosa da vedere, chissà granché. Vengono solo principalmente per quel motivo. E andiamo a vedere The Church of the Movie, la chiesa del film, dove hanno registrato la scena del matrimonio e il padrino. Oppure andiamo al cimitero, se ci sono, vediamo se ci sono mafiosi senza il loro nome nelle tombe, quindi delle tombe ignote. Questo vengono a vedere. Però sai qual è il fatto? Che poi rimangono delusi. Perché alla fine non trovano quel che vogliono, che cercano realmente. Trovano tutt'altro cosa. Guardano, si stupiscono, mi fanno da foto, mi ritrovo poco. Ciao, a casa.
Quickly, the woman you saw in the in the video is the director of the Anti-Mafia Center, because when I in Corleone, I met the local people, I met tourists, but I also came across a very important reality, which is the Anti-Mafia Center, and now we're gonna. She like helped me to understand better the reality of the village. And now one of the volunteers who worked with the Anti-Mafia Center is here to talk with us.
So we have a little surprise for those of you who have not received the email. Thanks to Maria's contact in Corleone, the Centro di Documentazione Antimafia agreed to join us live with Santina Lanza, who works there as a volunteer. And it's midnight, plus 30 minutes there, so we're particularly grateful. And given the time, we will anticipate some of the topics, and then Maria will continue on. As you have noticed, Corleone has become a destination for tourists, given the impact of this film. It is a tourism that is very transversal. It includes young people, old people coming from many different parts of the world. And Santina tonight will tell us about what the Anti-Mafia Center does with these visitors and the various activities over the years, and perhaps some anecdotes also about these visits. Good evening and welcome.
Good evening, nice to meet you. Thank you for having us today, tonight actually, for us. Well, as you were saying, I am a volunteer at CIDMA, and I've become part of the family in June 2017. But the CIDMA, so the International Center of Documentation about Mafia and the Anti-Mafia Movement, was opened in the year 2000. So there it is possible to have access to an incredibly important piece of the Sicilian history, which are the folders of the first big trial against the Sicilian criminal organization, Cosa Nostra, and a very suggestive exhibition of the world-known Sicilian photo reporter, Letizia Battaglia. But at first these pictures, these folders had no voice. So a few years later, a group of young people started to give voice to all this. And this is what we call the CIDMA family. This group of young people, we are a family which is growing continuously, and we are right now 18 people from 17 years old to 40, 44 years old. So what actually keeps us together is the desire to make people know that Corleone is not just the mafia, because most of the tourists that arrive in Corleone to know the mafia, they have seen The Godfather, and they want to see the places in which the movie was shot, but actually it was not shot in Corleone, so some are quite disappointed when we say there was once a man who arrived to Chitmo and asked, is this the Mafia Museum? Where can I find the mafia? And like, this is the anti-mafia museum, so sorry for you to hear that, but you have to talk to us if you want to find something different. And well, what makes us proud of what we do is that people like that, like arriving to Corleone with this stereotype that Corleone is mafia and all the people living in Corleone are mafiosi, then visit the center, and through our guided tour, what we do is like retracing a little bit the history of the Sicilian mafia and the anti-mafia movement in Corleone more in detail. And they get out of the center with a completely different point of view. We've had like visitors with tattoos of The Godfather. And then a man quite recently, it was probably a week ago, said, well, I'm sorry that I have to show you this, but I will do my best to delete it as soon as possible. And it's something that gives us also hope. It personally happened to me that a woman from the UK got out after the end of the visit and told me, because what we like, the mission is go out of the Chitmo with, like, by knowing that there have been anti-mafia people in Corleone, that Corleone is also rich of history, which is not related to the mafia. And this woman, I was like, I was born in Corleone, and every time I go abroad, everybody says, ah, then you are mafiosa, like a sort of joke. And I said, we are quite tired of hearing that. And this woman told me, I am deeply ashamed, and I cannot forget the way she told that. I'm deeply ashamed that I was one of these people who arrived to Corleone with this idea. So it's something that makes us think we are going towards the right direction, let's say.
Thank you. Can you tell us a little bit about where people come from?
We have visitors from everywhere in the world. Many visitors come from the US, and many visitors also from Russia, and then a little bit Italy as well, but Italians of course have different knowledge of the phenomenon. So most of the tourists who come from the US or from Russia have this idea of finding the Godfather in Corleone. While of course the Italians want to know a little bit more, like, about the history, the real history. And we have noticed like this different mindset, like really the desire of wanting to see bloody stories, like it is a fiction. And this is what we really want people to understand. It's not a movie.
Right, so they come with some kind of morbid interest about unpleasant stories that they would like to hear about, or to find any kind of physical reference to it actually in the, in the village. Now, of course, there is also the story of the mafia, as you said, because Corleone has been a place plagued by it, right? So can you tell us maybe a couple of essential aspects that you share with people so that they understand it outside The Godfather?
Yes, well, what we do is, like, starting from the Second World War, telling a little bit what really happened in Corleone. So speaking about some mafia families and the terror that was spread in those years until, like, more recent years, and making people know also the people who fought against the mafia in this period. And we've had the contribution of some artists, two Texan artists who made two beautiful murals, three portraits of three people who were active against the mafia in Corleone. So we helped the visitors understand the history through these new murals, which were made like last summer, and the pictures of Letizia Battaglia, which are very strong in a way, very suggestive. They really helped to understand how the society was in the 80s, in the 70s as well, and through the folders of the Maxi trial. So things happened. Those were careful years. Like my grandmother used to tell me that there were really people dying in the streets every day. But fortunately, this has changed right now. So we're here to witness like the good part now. We hope to make people aware of what was the past in order to avoid that we keep making the same mistakes, you know?
So it's both history and present. Their contribution, as you can imagine, is incredibly important. There are people who go to Corleone looking for Don Vito, looking for these morbid details, and the anti-mafia documentation center somewhat reroutes them and makes them aware through this education project of a different history and most importantly of what Corleone is today and Sicily is today without being aware of still some of the challenges, right, and some of the transformations of the mafia, but certainly the fact that it's not bloody and in the streets as it was before. We will, Santina, look at some pictures of your place later. If you want to stay with us, you're welcome, but it's probably a little bit late. And so we will continue to make references to the work you do.
Okay.
And would you like to add something else in closing?
Well, since we are also speaking about art and cinema, I wanted to tell that there was a film, the first real film to be shot in Corleone these days, which is Il Delitto Mattarella by Aurelio Grimaldi. So they made the shooting at Cittma as well. So this is also something we are very proud of. And then, well, I don't know if I can stay with you a little bit longer, but we have another project, it's work in progress project, which is Corleone on the road, because we would like to go also out of Corleone and to make Corleone known for other things than for the mafia. But for now, this is just like a work in progress, but we are on Facebook, on Instagram, Corleone, Cittma Corleone, so you can follow what we do if you like to, or visit our website. I don't know, it's nice to have people from the other part of the world knowing what we do. So if you have any curiosity, you can still contact us on other occasions, you know?
Thank you very much. Thank you for joining us and good luck with all your projects. And we know that it's always a challenge. You can imagine how difficult it is to find funding for this operation. It's impressive that there are 18 people volunteering for it. And speaking of films, as you remember, on December 5th, that we actually had the screening of Sicilian Ghost Story here by Antonio Piazza and Fabio Grassadonia, and other important statement about anti-mafia with young people involved. And so this all contributes to show different aspects of the island. Thank you, Santina, and good luck with your work. Technology helped us.
different, I think it's a different kind of movie because it's about the assassination of Mattarella. And I think that's why she mentioned that, because it's going to be a totally different view of the mafia. It's like on the other side, like what mafia really did in Sicily.
And Mattarella, for those of you don't know, was the brother of the current president of the Republic in Italy. Again, a very important statement in terms of where the country has wanted to go at some point in terms of fighting the mafia. We will return to your project then with the pictures.
Yes, with the pictures, yes. So, okay, the previous video that we saw, that is like a 4-channel video installation. And as you can see, I was interviewing tourists as well as local people. I was, by the time I was kind of hiding between, like, between tourists, I was trying to pretend to be a tourist when I was attending this tourist, like the tour, anti-mafia tours. But I was also talking to the local people and trying to get really closer into the idea that they have about their own, the village and what and how the village is seen abroad. All the images that you see of like the landscape, I filmed them from a car because there was a man who was like very helpful because he helped me to, he drove me basically around the village. And the first initial part of that, of this work, we didn't show it here, but the first 3 minutes are, there is a voiceover and the voices of this man was driving me. And it was kind of interesting because at one point I asked him if we wanted to talk about the life of a mafia boss or a real mafia boss. And he decided, he described the life of this mafia boss who could be considered the new Don Vito, who recently died in prison, Totorina. And he described the story of this guy as he saw it in a TV series because he wasn't able to. He was so afraid of telling the story of this guy as a reality, but for him it was much easier to tell it through the fiction. So it was, I couldn't film him while he was telling that because he was very scared, but I could record his voice. And then, yeah, you have to imagine me sitting next to him while he was driving me around this village, and it was really, really incredible. So going back to the rest of the works that I made during my residency in Corleone, these are some photographs and there is also a video that I made of people who play balls every day, bullying basically, it's like in this park. And the title of this work is Waiting for Nothing, because I was really intrigued by the fact that they were like every day going there. It was a beautiful light. It was a perfect weather, and they play every day, just, you know, waiting for the day to end. But there were also other people who were playing in that park, and they were playing cards, and they were like playing with a lot of money, and they were very annoyed by me filming them. So the video of people playing bowling is pretty long, and it's you can just, I mean, it's long, it's like it's 10 minutes, they could film a lot. And then you can see only, you don't see the faces of these people playing, you just see their legs. And then you see like very strong, you can hear very strong noises of the balls like crashing. So in every mind of like some gun shootings. Whether the other people were playing cards, they were very fast. So I have a 1 minute video, like video, and then they at one point they told me you can't film us, you just have to go. I was like, okay, I'm sorry. So this was my first impact in the village, and then after I tried, I started to interview them and I started to interview tourists. But at the same time, and we can go to the other image. Yeah, at the same time what I was noticing was that all the houses were very, very close like to each other. Like you have to imagine this very old Sicilian village. And then I made this work, which is a light box of these two balconies that are connected with a string, because people sometimes used to, like, they used to pass things or food from one balcony to another one, so there is a strong connection. But the reason why I made this work is because I realized while I was there that really the, like, Corleone people can be mafiosi, cannot be mafiosi. They really live together. They coexist in a very small place, but there is a big distinction between mafiosi and non-mafiosi. And then the other, these other photos are, as the guy said in my video, I also was a tourist and I also wanted to visit the cemetery. And it's true, there are all of these tombs that are without names. And I asked, I was very curious, I wanted to know, and actually found out there's kind of interesting the reason why there are no names. There are no names because most of these people were killed by mafia. And there are two reasons why there are no names. One is because the family didn't want to be the tombs to be destroyed or damaged, and those are the families of mafia people, like other mafia families could damage the tombs. But other reasons, the other big reason is because mafia has always been one of the biggest elements of mafia silence, or it's the same thing that the old man said. Mafia doesn't exist. You don't see it if you don't talk. If you don't say anything, it doesn't exist. It starts to exist. Of course, it's not true, but it's actually true. The fact that this is what mafia wanna be. It wanna be completely invisible, and silence is the main element of survival, basically. So yeah, then okay, this is an image of the what it. Oh, okay, sorry, I'm zooming. Okay, so this is Letizia Battaglia. Actually, it's the volunteer at Chitma mentioned her. Letizia Battaglia is a very famous photographer. Now she's in her 80s, but she was very famous in the 70s and 60s because she was photographing a lot of mafia murders. She was a very brave woman, I would say, and she was the only woman who ever had the courage to do this. And to be honest with you, I mean, I don't know any other artist who ever talked about mafia besides me and Letizia, and I don't know why, because, I mean, I might imagine why, but to me it was an urgency. I needed to talk about it as a Sicilian. I needed to find out more, I needed to describe more, and bring this up. And I think she had the same urgency, but probably not everybody. But and then, yeah, this is like an image of the village and the Chitma, the anti-mafia center that we mentioned before. It's kind of interesting because the volunteer mentioned briefly that they have the maxi trial documentation. This is a very important thing because at in this anti-mafia center, tourists can see more than 360 folders that are part of the first maxi trial. There were four maxi trials in total, and this the first one was very important because is still considered the most important anti-mafia trial in the world. There were more than 400 defendants. Many, many people were arrested. And it was so important because for the first time, mafia in Sicily was considered as a criminal trial, and a criminal organization, and so could be, people could be accused, there could be a trial. And that was for me very, the core of my project at the end was this, and I was like, and then I was like, realized why I was there, and I said, okay, this is gonna be the end, but really the beginning and the whole core of my project, talking about this this archive. So this is a diptych where you can see a view of the village, and these are part of this 360 folders that are very damaged, but badly kept because Italian government even doesn't really want to take care of it because there are still a lot of names of politicians and people who are still alive. But this is the first folder I ever photographed, and it's really important because this is the most important folder. The whole trial started because a former mafia boss who decided to collaborate with justice, Tommaso Buscetta, decided to talk with a judge, Giovanni Falcone, and he decided to tell him everything he knew about this criminal organization. Tommaso Buscetta is probably famous here too because he lived in the United States, and it was very important because he was an important connection between Italy and Sicily and the United States and Brazil. He was a very charismatic figure. I remember I was a child when the trial took place, and I remember seeing, like, we couldn't see him in the face when he was talking, was witnessing, but he was clearly a very strong person and charismatic. And it was very important because he decided to tell everything. And when I say everything, I mean how this criminal organization is structured. And it's important because mafia has always been one of the main characteristics of mafia is like it was always trying to be, as I say before, invisible, which means also never really wanted to show or reveal its own identity, but in fact it has an identity and it's really organized, and there are rules and there are like a lot of structures and he revealed everything, also about the rituals they have, a lot of curious things, like the relation they have with women, for example. They never, they are very respectful with women. It's kind of, and they, for example, the fact that they never, one of the rules was never kill a boy, a little boy, but in fact they did at one point. But anyway, that, like a lot of things that are kind of interesting, and the relation with religion, the fact that they were like burning some santini, which are these little, how do you say, like figurines of saints, and that was a sign of agreement, and also was a sign of low trust between the mafiosi. Anyway, we can see another folder. Yeah, these are okay. So this is like another folder, and then the other, the 36 one. So these are only 36 of the folders that I photographed, but I photographed already 360. So hopefully will be able to exhibit them all together, and I want to make a publication of it. This is a work about labor. I don't reveal anything because these folders are closed, you don't see anything, but you can see the amount of work that the two judges, Falcone and Borsellino, spent in making this trial. When I say Falcone and Borsellino, I mention these two people who are very important because they really had the courage of fight against everybody, especially the state. The state didn't help them. This is the reality, unfortunately. In fact, they were killed by mafia at the end of the fourth trial. And they were killed because they, at the end of the fourth, the last sentence, they condemned all of the mafiosi. Although mafia really wanted to have some, you know, they tried everything possible to have less people in jail, but it didn't work. So they, as a response, they were killed. But this was probably the last very important like assassination, and this was the last act, violent act, because after that the mafia boss who ordered the assassination was arrested, and the next one, which is Dottorina, and the next mafia boss, this guy, and the next mafia boss was Provenzano, and Provenzano had a totally different policy, let's say. And it was, when I talk about silence, I say that because he decided that from that point on, mafia would have acted in like silently without blood. That's why for since like late 80s, no, I mean let's say late 90s, there haven't been assassinations. But then Provenzano also died in prison. He's the guy who was hiding for 43 years. He was hiding for 20 something years. So this is the Don Vito Corleone, basically. Yeah. And the last photos I want to show you are these little sculptures, porcelain sculptures that they made, and I presented them in an exhibition together with the folders because I wanted to make a work about memory, about let's say personal memory and historical memory. So the folders are related to history, Italian history, but these are related to my memories because when I was a child, I was coming home from every day from school. We have, you know, in Italy we have lunch. It's important to have lunch with parents. Still, it's important. But by the time I was like 11, 10, and every day they were like in the news, they were showing the Maxi trial. Every day I was like, for 3 years, I was seeing these people behind bars or talking. And I collected all of these memories, and for me it was important to remake them as a sculpture. So I made the analog TV, like a small size, of course, the scale of this, that we had, like a small car. You can see the details of the other. You can go to the, okay, this one. The cigar that one of the bosses was always holding, it was Michele Greco. Michele Greco was called the Papa. It was like most of these files, the folders that they photographed in the trial are like, I would say 50-60% of them are for this guy because he was the guy who was dealing with the money, with business, and he was in charge of the finance. And then there is that is yet a book that reminds me of the agenda of one of the judges who were killed because after the judge was killed, they never found this agenda rossa, they call it, because it was a red diary in agenda, and it was like when he was writing everything, and nobody ever found it, and it's still a mystery, it's still a big mystery in Italian history. We still don't know where it is, if it's still somewhere, or if it was destroyed immediately. And the last photo I want to show, it's probably one of this chair with this microphone is probably one of my most vivid memories of that time, because at one point they decided that they were broadcasting the trial, but at one point they decided it was too dangerous to show the face of the witnesses of this mafiosi, so they decided to film them the back of them. So the chair was like they were facing the camera. So what I remember is this chair, this microphone, and this silhouette of these people talking. And then on the other photo, there is a small sculpture of the table. I saw this, I found this photograph, and I made a sculpture out of the photograph. It was like the table, the desk where like Falcone Borsellino, the two judges were working on, and those are all the folders. Basically, when I say that the state that didn't really help these two judges, is because while during the process and during of this trial, they were working in a super small room in a very very small table, and in the darkness basically, and they were like paid very little to do this, and then they paid everything with their life. So this is a small like memory also of that, which I think is kind of important to remember because. You know, this is the reality, it's not like in the fiction, like we see in the movie. But I can end here, or you can ask me some questions, or you can.
Thank you, Maria.
You want to add something?
The project, as you can see, works on many levels. It's documentation of the documentation,
personal memories, meetings with people, interviews, and it really was prompted by curiosity. And I know that many students have been curious also about this project because we've been working with groups to produce questions, and so I would like to invite them to ask them, and of course anybody in the hall can also join for the Q&A at this point. Edward.
Yeah, so when you were talking to the people in Corleone, it took a lot of like to get them to talk, obviously, like they might have been like seeing you as an outsider and they didn't want to talk. So how were you able to get on their favorable side to get them to talk more about the mafia and things about that way?
So the first time I went to Corleone just to visit, I was with my boyfriend, and the approach was completely different. We were visiting, he was so scared. He was like, why are we here? What are we doing here? He's also Sicilian. And I was like, you're crazy. And then I said, okay, I know what I'm gonna do. So the second time I went there, I was by myself. And it was totally different because I had a very positive approach with them. I wasn't scared. I knew there was nothing to be afraid of. Also, I am Sicilian, I speak Sicilian. So when I started talking to them, I was not a real tourist. I was, for them, I was not a stranger. So when the first thing I was telling them immediately was like, I'm from Catania. Oh, and they were like, oh, so, you know, immediately, because it's so rare that Sicilians go there, for them was such a surprise that I was interesting in talking to them. And they couldn't see me as a stranger or someone they should be scared of. Then I said I was, they were asking me, what are you doing here? You're not, they immediately realized I was not a journalist. I was not in the police. It was like, who are you? And I said, I'm an artist. And then I was like, okay, she's crazy, so this needed a reading. So to me, saying I'm Sicilian and I'm an artist was totally, they were totally trusting me. They had no idea, I had a camera, but they had no idea how powerful that camera was. Just completely unaware of that. And then I also, you know, it's important, every time I've done a lot of other works like this, it's always important to interact with people because I didn't want to steal anything. I just wanted to create a communication with them. So for example, now I remember it, that some of this, especially the old men, I took them some photographs, and I gave them these photographs to them. They were so happy that someone was photographing them. I never showed them, they're like, they're personal portraits. But that was my approach to them, the way to say, don't worry, I'm not trying to let you say something that you don't want to say. I just want to know more.
I have a question. I'm struck by the anonymity in your work, that your graphic work, which is what you speak about. I haven't seen much anything else of your work. I don't, if you have portraits, but what you showed us tonight was anonymous. Very beautiful graphic images, but totally anonymous. The other thing I wanted to ask you is, I know in Catania, there's street art with almost like caricatures of people that have been killed by the mafia with their names. So could you speak a little bit about maybe the differences between the two sides of the island, and also why in Catania the victims, as it were, are identified?
I don't think it's only in Catania. I think nowadays everywhere in Sicily.
So they have the same type of street art with caricatures and names?
They've been doing a lot in also in Palermo. I don't know if they have this kind of graffiti, but there is a lot of consciousness now, especially after the two judges were killed. Like the image, that's an iconic image, the image of the two judges. It's everywhere. People usually, also when there are demonstrations, they also put the image outside of their balconies. So it's something that is really, people are very conscious of it. They're not afraid of this anymore. I don't understand what you mean when you say anonymous. In my work, you mean there are no names or there's no information?
They struck me more as not pupil images, of default images being, you know, graphically composed, very, you know, diagonal lines, shadows,
well,
tonality is very neutral.
Yeah. Well, I don't make documentaries. It's more video art, and I usually like to talk about places, and places sometimes describe also people. In this specific work, there are people talking, but recently I really haven't used people, interviewing people. That was probably the last project I did by interviewing. So it's not, I prefer to use locations and places, but every time I show this work, or if you go on my website, there are names, there's like everything, I describe everything. So it's not, secret.
Thank you.
Students, yes, Ryan?
You said at the beginning that kind of digging into this kind of brought up a lot of, unpleasant memories of growing up in Sicily, and this was kind of the dark side, of how does it make you feel that our society in America, we almost romanticize the mafia? Because even when you say these things, a lot of people, they think of movies that we've seen, and although we know it's criminal activity, how it's portrayed to us is appealing in a sick way. And for us, as innocent bystanders, it's just sheer entertainment. But for somebody like you, who's actually from there, and you know people that were actually affected, and people that know people that were killed and murdered, what do Sicilians, what do you think of that representation that we see that's really inaccurate?
We have a totally different view, a totally different approach with that. That's why I said in the beginning, I watched The Godfather for the first time in my life 10 years ago. Fiction and movies are, it's the same thing as we grow up watching American movies. So when I came to New York, and I saw, when I went to the United States, I was like, oh, this really doesn't look exactly how I thought it was. It's, but that's the fiction, that's what they do. I remember as a child, the very first mafia movie I watched was this TV series called La Piovra. And it was so, so strong for me to watch it. I don't know if you guys remember that. It was so strong, it was so touching. I watched the first episode and I couldn't watch it anymore. For me, I was scared. To me, it was something that I didn't want to deal with at all. And until very late, when I decided to start this project, I was already aware of the fact that I was always trying to keep distance from that violence. And still nowadays, I cannot watch violent movies. And I think it's because of the time I was a child, they were real. There was real violence in Sicily. For example, I cannot watch violent scenes in The Godfather. I just move on. I close my eyes. I think it affected me, and that's why I cannot really understand the other people. View of this phenomenon as something that is spectacular, but at the same time, if you just watch the movie, of course you can be fascinated.
I was just gonna say, do you think it's because in America, when we see that, we see so much of it, so we know it's entertainment or it's a game, but for you, when you see it, the reason you're having such a visceral response to that is because you know that these things actually do happen very close to where you're from.
Yeah, but also I think the fascination of violence, that's something normal in people. We are so attracted by something that is violent. But in my case, I wasn't, and I'm not about movies about mafia, because for me, it's reality, it's not fiction, so I cannot watch it.
I thought that perhaps this, we can show the ending also
in
the video, because there's another reference that ties in very well with Brian's comment of when the director of the Documentation Center actually mentions the fact that Corleone became also famous or Palermo for the Maxi trial, right? And this was her reaction.
Sono realtà molto diverse. Cioè, la persona onesta e il mafioso non potranno mai camminare insieme. L'uno non capirà mai l'altro.
This is very important, it's very relevant, because it's so true. Yeah.
In fact, you know, the moment you don't belong to it, obviously, you just feel foreign to it, and its spectacularization obviously creates this type of disappointment, and this is why they created also the center, right, to fight against this image. There was a question from the students, I don't know if they're still here, about the tourism. Are the students here? Do they want to ask this question about
Est-ce que je peux aller chez Marion samedi?
Growing because of this, it seems to be quite of an influx of people. Fundamentally, they tour Sicily and then they make sure that they include a visit to Corleone. In some cases, they go to Corleone Strait. And as you can imagine, there are also people who are originally from there and go back to find their families. So it's an interesting mix. But is the town profiting from it, at least. Okay. Some of the students were interested in the positive outcome.
I don't think so. I mean, last time I visited Corleone was a few years ago, but the first time when I spent time there was 10 years ago. Now it might be different because there are more tourists, but I don't think they get that any profit because tourists usually spend there one day, no less than a day. So maybe restaurants, yes, lunchtime, but they don't sleep there. They just go visit the anti-mafia center, and then go home. So it's not really.
Any other curiosity? Yes, ma'am.
Where do you expect to show your
where?
You're still going to be photographing more.
Oh no! This is I consider this as like a finished project. I was working on this for many years, and the final. The final part of the project is like the documentation of the archive of the Maxi file. I would like to show it here and also in Italy, that because I finally finished the folder. It wasn't easy to document all these folders because I needed permissions every time and it took me years because every time I could photograph only a few of these books. So now, I mean, this particular video has been exhibited in Italy and it was exhibited also in England many times. So the old works and also the photographs, but the complete series of the documentation of the archive hasn't been presented yet. But
you hope.
Oh yeah, I would like. I mean, it's really to me it's like this project is not just one of another art projects that I've done. This is to me represents more, and I'm happy that some of this. Books like the 36 photographs of the books and also the porcelain sculptures are now in Milan and they're in a office but it's like facing the Piazza Duomo so people basically can see it and I from outside tourists and to me it's important but not just because it's my work presented it could have been another one but because I am happy that people can see the books of the Maxi trial. To me, it's really important that this still, like, to keep the memory alive, of this.
Yes, go ahead.
How long did you stay in Corleone?
Oh, I visited Corleone many times, but just short, briefly. The only moment, the only time I spent more time was 2 weeks. So in 2 weeks time, I have a lot of more material. This is like only few works that I'm showing here. I made more works.
There is a,
can you see the
hand? I'm sorry. Yes, go ahead.
Are you surprised that, you know, I don't know if you're recently at Staten Island, Mafia boss was recently killed, Frank Cali, who's one of the bosses of the five families, the Gavino family. Are you almost surprised, like, you see a lot more activity here than you actually do, like, in Corleone?
It's a different kind of activity, I think. I don't know, in Italy they don't kill anymore. I mean, Sicilian mafia doesn't kill anymore. Then there is mafia from Naples and Calabria. They still kill a lot. It's very, very violent, but not in Sicily. I don't know here if they still, but there is still a strong connection. It's political. It's really political now. Yeah, I'm kind of interested because I recently heard like Letizia Battaglia talking about it. People were asking her like, can you see mafia? Can you photograph more mafiosi? And she was like, I can't photograph them anymore because they're all wearing like white shirts and like suits, so I cannot really recognize them. They're everywhere. Like, okay. Yeah. Yes, Marie.
Yeah, I thought it was interesting you mentioned, you know, funding. Like, where does Chidma get its funding? I mean, you assume it's difficult, right? Where do you get your funding?
They've been trying to close it, like the political administrations, like the town hall. They've been trying to close it so many times. They survived because they recently started asking, I think, like €3 to the people who go there, €3 each visitor, so they can keep it open. But nobody's paid there. They're all volunteers. They can pay like bills, electricity, or
Though what struck me is that when I tried the Zoom this morning with them, which was I guess the afternoon in Corleone, they were wearing the coats. So I guess it's not easy to pay the heating bills. And then your question was also about how did you fund the project?
Yes.
Also. Your own project. Your own, who supported that?
Myself. I mean, it was pretty cheap to spend 2 weeks in Corleone. And I did everything by myself. I was like filming.
Great. So why don't we close actually listening to the voice of a young person from the video with some other images that Maria has described for us.
Qualche proiettile davanti alla porta viene lasciato, ma non è più come prima, ringraziando Dio. E se fosse come prima io per ora non neanche potrei parlare, capito? Anche se secondo me l'avrei fatto. Perché una cosa mia innata, non essere sottomesso da questa cosa, questa ombra.
Thank you.
see you again on April 15th for the next Interact event. It's going to be about art, industry, and public spaces with another Sicilian artist, as a matter of fact, Francesco Simeti, and other guests to talk about community. Thank you very much.
That's the email.